हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम
कृषि संस्कृति जनमंगलम कृषि कार्यश आयुर्बलम
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम
दक्षिण गाथा गुर्जरी गिरिकुंज वन सृष्टि भरी दक्षिण गाथा गुर्जरी गिरिकुंज वन सृष्टि भरी भूमि स्नेह शीतल साक्षरी स्नेह शीतल साक्षरी सागर सुमन सरिता भरी
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम
संझान उदवाड़ा स्मृति जरथोष्ट्र आतश संस्कृति उपराट तीर्थल आहवा और डांग डुम्मस वेड़छी
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम
कल्याण जी कंडेल डांगी खारवा हलपति अनाविल पारसी
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम
नमक सत्याग्रही गांधी गिरा गरुड़ेश्वरी दांडी नमक सत्याग्रही गांधी गिरा गरुड़ेश्वरी सरदार सरोवर नर्मदा सरदार सरोवर नर्मदा हे कंकरा सब शंकरा हे कंकरा सब शंकरा
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम धन्य धान्य औषधि संपन्नम्।
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम् धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम्।
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम् धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम्।
कृषि संस्कृति जनमंगलम् कृषिकारयश आयुर्बलम्।
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम् धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम्।
दक्षिण गाथा गुर्जरी गिरिकुंज वन सृष्टि भरी। दक्षिण गाथा गुर्जरी गिरिकुंज वन सृष्टि भरी। भूमि स्नेह शीतल साक्षरी सागर सुमन सरिता भरी।
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम् धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम्।
संजान उद्वाड़ा स्मृति जरथोष्ट्र आतश संस्कृति। उपराट तीथल आहवा और डांग डुम्मस वेड़छी।
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम् धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम्।
कल्याण जी कंडेल डांगी खारवा हलपति अनाविल पारसी।
हे समस्त रिद्धि कृषि मूलम् धन धान्य औषधि संपन्नम्।
नमक सत्याग्रही गांधी गिरा गरुड़ेश्वरी। दांडी नमक सत्याग्रही गांधी गिरा गरुड़ेश्वरी। सरदार सरोवर नर्मदा सरदार सरोवर नर्मदा है कंकरा सब शंकरा है कंकरा सब शंकरा
है समस्त रिधि कृषि मूलम धन धान्य औषधि संपदम धन धान्य औषधि संपदम धन धान्य औषधि संपदम।
You are now unmuted.
Good morning to all. Myself, Dr. Lalit Modi, Co-Organizing Secretary of this VET NIU Webinar Series 2020, along with Dr. Deepak Suthar, Organizing Secretary of this VET NIU Webinar Series, I welcome to all in this 20th webinar as a part of VET NIU Webinar Series 2020, topic on Basic of Wildlife Rescue Management, Focusing of Man versus Animal Conflict, delivered by Dr. Hars Prajapati, our today's speaker. I welcome to all the participants as well as Dr. Hars Prajapati. Before starting the webinar, we have a message from our Dean, Principal and Dean, Dr. V.B. Kharadi, sir, College of Veterinary Science and Animal Husbandry. So, Dr. V.B. Kharadi, sir, please.
You are now muted.
Good morning to all. I hope you all are safe and well at your place in this COVID-19 situations. We all know that due to the coronavirus, we all are under the lockdown period, which has affected the education of the students. But to mitigate this issue, Navsari Agriculture University, Navsari has developed e-class facility for the students under the guidance of Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Sunil Chaudhary, and I am happy to announce that all the teachers of Veterinary College used this facility and completed the remaining curriculum during the lockdown period and also successfully completed the online examinations. In addition to this, our teachers, Dr. Deepak Suthar and Dr. Lalit Modi, also started VET NIU Webinar Series 2020 on the various topics on clinical aspects for the benefit of undergraduate and postgraduate students, field veterinarians, as well as the teachers. I appreciate that the efforts are made by Dr. Suthar and Dr. Modi to use this critical COVID-19 period very efficiently to improve the knowledge of the students and veterinarian working in the field through the digital platform provided by the IT department of the university. The VET NIU webinar is not only useful for the Gujarat students and veterinarians, but also almost useful globally as per the participant registered in various webinars. I congratulate Dr. Suthar and Dr. Modi for the success of the WET NIV webinar series 2020 and wish them the best of the luck for the future endeavor. Thank you.
You are now unmuted.
Thank you, sir, for your beautiful words and providing the facility for the betterment of this webinar series. So now I would like to just introduce about our today's speaker, Dr. Harsh Prajapati. Dr. Harsh Prajapati graduated from College of Veterinary Science and Animal Husbandry, Anand Agriculture University, Anand, in the year 2017. After completion of his graduation, he joined the Dan district as a veterinary officer. And after that, he joined Sasan Gir Forest, Gujarat, as a veterinary officer. And now he has a very good knowledge of wildlife, particularly rescue management, wildlife rescue management. I would just brief about Sasan Gir. This is a Gir National Park and wildlife. It is also known as Sasan Gir. It is a forest and wildlife sanctuary near Talala district, Gir, in Gujarat. Gir National Park and Wildlife Sanctuary is the only area in Asia where Asiatic lions occur and is considered one of the most important protected area in Asia because of its biodiversity. The Gir ecosystem with its diverse flora and fauna is protected as a result of the efforts of the Government Forest Department, wildlife activist and NGOs. It is now considered the jewel of Gujarat ecological resources. So this is about the Gir National Park, Miss Sasan Gir. Dr. Harsh Prajapati is already work over in Sasan Gir forest area. So he has a very good exposure of wildlife rescue management. Before starting the webinar, the few instructions for the participants. Please off your mic as well as the webcam during all the presentation of Dr. Harsh Prajapati. If you have any doubt or question, please write down in chat box only. Please write down in chat box only. It will be answered or cleared by our today's speaker after completion of his presentation. So please follow the instruction. It will be definitely helpful for us to fulfill or complete run up of this webinar. So now I request Dr. Harsh Prajapati, please start the webinar. Dr. Harsh, please.
Good morning to everyone.
You are now
one of the panelists will please confirm if I'm audible or not.
You are
yes,
now
doctor, you are audible.
Okay, thank you so much, Suthar sir.
So
I would like to thank everyone and welcome everyone to this seminar, and also good morning to everyone. The organizers have selected this date, that is 4th October, and this is actually in fact a week, entire week dedicated to wildlife, called Wildlife Week, which is from 2nd October to 8th October. And in this time, we are like, as a veterinarian, we are presenting this presentation, which is partially related to all the peoples who are working in the wildlife field. And a majority of its part will be focused on the veterinarians. So we'll just start it. So the topic of this presentation will be basics of wildlife rescue management, which will be entirely focused on the man versus animal conflict and some roles of veterinarians, which every veterinarians throughout the world or throughout the India should keep in mind, since we all know that in our veterinary education, there are like none of the colleges, as far as I know, are providing exclusively veterinary wildlife knowledge. And we have only 6 months dedicated to wildlife knowledge. and that is quite a lesser amount of time period we are getting to study. And there are few actually institutions are there who are giving educations to veterinarian who are interested in working with wildlife. We'll talk about it later. So this will be focused on the role of veterinarians also. And any veterinarian who is a student or budding veterinarian or any old veterinarian who is practicing since their life, it will be beneficial for their as their basic knowledge. Some basic fundas will be cleared so that they can apply those fundamental rules whenever they are getting any wildlife cases throughout their working period. So we'll start from understanding the wildlife word. What is wildlife? Some children might say the dog is wildlife. Some educated person might say panther or monkey is a wildlife. So to understand what wildlife exactly means, we'll have to dig our own history that is like 2.5 million years ago. So we as a human species were like roaming around in the jungles, just like any gorilla right now roaming around in the forest of Amazon or any jungles. So we were living exactly like them. Then nearly 12,000 years ago, we started evaluating ourselves and then we evolved. And then slowly and slowly we understood the concept of domestication, and we started domesticating certain animals. Currently, certain those animals who are domesticated are they were previously same as us, wildlife only, but we domesticated them. And some examples of them are cattle, buffalo, sheep, goat, poultry, and some other lab animals. Even these stray animals, which are dogs and cat, those are also domesticated ones. So the ideal definition of wildlife would be all flora and fauna, in which flora is these animals or living form, and fauna is plant forms, are living in the natural habitat and not cultivated or domesticated by humans. So all those animals who are still currently living by their own and not domesticated, not cultivated with by humans, they are called wildlife. And zoologist or biologist, I would say, during their they have spent their lifetimes to classify them, and their classification is based on this genetic makeup and their anatomical these different points. They have classified them into kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genera, and species. So as far as our country India is concerned, there are some numerical values which shows the family wise number of species we have. You know, as an example of biodiversity, I would say. So here there are like 420 plus reptiles are there, 340 plus mammals are there, more than 1200 species of birds are there, and more than 2000 species of fish are there, and there are lots of amphibians and insects are also there. So before we go into this our presentation and focus on the main topic, there are few things I would like to mention. And that is, being a veterinarian, first and foremost thing you must have in your mind is Wildlife Protection Act. So again, I'll be talking about it in like 2 to 3 slides only, but this is very deep topic. And every veterinarian must have a little bit knowledge of Wildlife Protection Act. And it will be the latest copy of Wildlife Protection Act will be shared if any participants want it. So Wildlife Protection Act came into existence in 1972. And before that, there were lots and lots of poaching, animal killing, animal abusing were happening. And our biodiversity were in threat, you know, that it might get extinct slowly. So our government decided to pass an act, which is Wildlife Protection Act, and it was passed in 1972. So it is quite big, as I said, but there are few points that I would like to mention. So what is their Wildlife Protection Act's objective? So their objective is to protect wildlife flora and fauna. It includes every wild animal which are not domesticated or which is not human. Every animal is protected under Wildlife Protection Act. As per their numbers of species existing in wildlife, they have divided them into various classes, and they have also given different kind of importance and different kind of protection as per their classes, or I would say schedules. They have also the power to create and develop protected areas. So for example, I would say Gir National Park is an example that when they realize that our native and one and only species, which is entirely throughout the India, it is seen in Gujarat only, it was in threat, and then they decided to declare it as a national park and wildlife sanctuary also. So under this declared region, they have several private or personal acts, or I would say rules, that in those rules and in under those particular area, they are protected and given very much significance. They can, they are also in under this act, they have also declared some scheduled species, and the schedule depends on the numbers and vulnerability of animal in the wildlife. So, and also any unlawful activity against animal, if anyone is killing any animal or poaching or abusing the animal, or even in fact if anyone kills any animal in the road accident in protected areas, so all of these acts are unlawful activities, and Wildlife Protection Act has power to work against those activities. So as I said, these are various schedules. There are basically 6 schedules, but I have mentioned up to 5 only. And schedule 1 to schedule 5, when we go, so the vulnerability of animal decreases. So schedule 1 animals are most vulnerable animals and given much more significance and important, and then schedule 5 animal. So there are some examples only. There are various animals has been included into this species, into the schedules. So tigers, lion, all big cats, and rock python, Indian peafowl, crocodile, then bison, elephant, rhino. These all of the animals are included in schedule 1. And common crow or fruit bat or mice and rat are included in schedule 5. As per their numbers and vulnerability of numbers in the wild. So again, some examples of wild this animal poaching or animal abusing, or I would say example of why one should apply Wildlife Protection Act in this country. So the right one above image, you can see that parakeet, which is also scheduled bird, it has been kept as a captive in some cage. So this is against Wildlife Protection Act. Our focusing topic, which is animal and man conflict, which is basically seen in some greater species of animal, which are like in big cats, you can see tiger, leopards, lion. Those animals are involved in man-animal conflict. Some greater reptiles, for example, crocodile, pythons, and some primates, like monkeys and macaques. So those animals are involved in conflict, and in most of the cases, animal used to kill those animals. And so second one image is an example of wild animal and man conflict. Also these superstitions related madari culture, or I would say circus, where in past time madari culture was so flourishing that in every street, madaris were playing with mongoose. They used to keep animals as a captive animal. Even Himalayan bear or these bears were also used to kept as a captive animal and to play in circus. So these all activities are unlawful as per the Wildlife Protection Act. And in madari culture, I would also like to mention that the animal abuse is happening in a so much tremendous bad way that even they are not hesitating cutting their venom glands. If they have any cobra or crate snake, then they will cut open the venom gland, and so thus the venom gland will not be working. And even they remove these fangs, which are actually modified teeth, which delivers the venom from venom gland. So Madari is used to do this thing, and it is also an example of man-animal conflict and animal abused by our own species, which is Homo sapiens. Another example is mongoose being killed in a roadkill accident, which is also punishable under Wildlife Protection Act. Again, some animals are kept as a captive. Usually these macaques are very trendy. And nowadays they keep macaques as a captive animal. And the image in the left is an example of two poachers being caught by forest department, who have these various kind of nets and threads and all of this material to catch usually smaller mammals like mongoose and this hare, or I would say rabbit. So these animals are being poached and being eaten by some of the poachers. So it is not only their that their organs or body parts are being collected. There are some people in India that they are eating some animals. So that is also punishable under Wildlife Protection Act. Another culture that is flourishing nowadays is wildlife photography, and I am not opposing it as it is, but some of the photographers, there is a thing called ethical photography, and there are some rules that you are not allowed to abuse any animal or disturb any animal in order to have any great photograph. So for wildlife photography is allowed to do, but one should know their limits. One should know how to do ethical photography, and one should always keep maintaining the boundaries between you and animal and during the photography you are doing. So we'll slowly now focus on our point, which is rescue management and man-animal conflict and its resolution. So what can be the reason of rescue? So in most of the condition, there is no actually need of any kind of rescue. Some animals might have near the village, there is a forest area, and from forest area that animal has been entered into village, or either from in village there you can see most of the village are encountering snakes which enters into their home. So there is no need of actually rescuing those animals. They, like, their natural habitat is just nearby, so you can guide them and they can just be gone to their natural habitat. So in such cases there are no need of rescues, but in some special cases for example, social rejected animals care should be rescued and should be under the observation. Rejection is not only the situation. So in animal in fight or any conflict, the mother has been killed by human or other animal. So in such cases also animals, the babies get orphaned, and you need to rescue those animals. And another example is injury. So there might be variety of injury you can encountering. So the injury which is at the level at which you are supposed to treat them, you are supposed to keep them as a captive, or more days of attention is required. So in such cases you are allowed to take this animal to rescue center or shelter house. But if injury is very minor and wildlife has separate level of immunity, I would say, so they can the minor injury can be recovered naturally. So in such cases there is no need of rescuing animal. So veterinarians must have idea of allowing idea and knowledge to know and assess the case that this particular injury requires delayed attention. So in such cases only you are supposed to rescue the animal. Captivity, previous images I have shown, so some animals are being kept as a captive animal. So to rehabilitate them and to save them, there might be a need of rescue. The main topic, which is man-animal conflict, usually in these big reptiles, either alligator, crocodile, or I would say python, and primates and big cats. So these are the main species that has been involved in man-animal conflict. And in such cases, they have been entered to human habitation, or they have been attacking to some human in order to save themselves. So in such cases, there is an issue of man-animal conflict, and to resolve it, one should always prefer to rescue animal, and like considering safety of both animal and human. Also, as I said, stuck in human habitation is also one of the examples that you might require to rescue the animal. So I'll explain some of the examples with photograph. So the right left image, there is a monkey which is common langur or Hanuman langur, which is stuck inside the human home, and that is this photograph is from Sasangir, and Sasan is entire village is in middle of the forest. So animals tend to come into the human habitation and they stuck into it, and there can be a man-animal conflict. Animal, human might, some non-expert people might want to resolve the problem by their own, and the animal might get frightened. They might want to save themselves and they might attack to a human, and the issue can be much more serious. So in such case, you must be having knowledge of, applying very rapidly and very carefully. A photograph, the left, right one is of a python, which has been fallen into well. So in human habitation, python might, there are wells in farms, various in various region of this Gujarat. So such animals tend to fall in wall because they don't know during night time. They might have this vision imperfection, or they might have fallen during fight with other animal. So in such cases, you are supposed to rescue animal. So again, the image in left is another classic example of man-animal conflict. Animals as, humans are nowadays keeping these nets or electrocution kind of attachment to their boundaries of the farm. So during such cases, when wildlife is nearby or wildlife habitat is nearby, the animal might try to pass through these farms, and they might get stuck or they might get electrocuted themselves during this kind of defense mechanism which has been applied by farms or local village people. So in such a cases, animals get furious, they might get they might die, or there might be an attack on any human. So there are two examples. Image in left is describing the leopard cub which has been stuck in the nets that has been applied surrounded to these farms, agricultural farms. And another example is of a langur electrocuted on this electricity ropes. So those were the examples to when to carry out rescue operations. And now we'll discuss on the ideal procedure of rescue. And I would like to say here is, like, as far as wildlife is concerned, there is never gonna be a perfect rescue operation, because you don't know what is the situation is gonna be. So there are some basic rules that I have built and to work with, so that you can carry out nearly a perfect rescue operation. So basically three points are there that every veterinarian should keep in mind, is planning, equipment, and approach. So we'll see one by one in detail. So what is planning? So whenever you get any call from any NGO or any village that there is a need of rescuing an animal, then you must be having an idea that for which particular animal you are going to deal with. So if there is a bird that has been stuck into someone's home, then there is no need of taking that gun or big cages with you. So it depends on the species how you are going to deal. And some main points to consider while planning the rescue operation is team, like the people or group of people to whom you want to bring them with. And in team, there must be like few qualities are there or few necessities are there while considering the team, which is if that particular animal which is being rescued is from vulnerable schedule, or I would say from schedule 1 to 2, you must include any forest officials with you, because the responsible person for whole particular wildlife is a person from forest department or any officer from forest department. So there can be a presence of range forest officer, which is RFO. There can be deputy forest officer, which is DFO. Or DFO is actually responsible for whole district level wildlife he has under his supervision. So for specially schedule 1, you must have DFO with you, whether it is post-mortem examination, whether it is rescue operation, or whatever it is, you must include DFO in your team, because that person is the responsible person as far as schedule 1 to 3 is concerned and as far as wildlife is concerned. And another person you want to involve with you is a good driver, or a good a driver with having knowledge of particular geography that you are going to deal with, and a good person who is expert in the handling certain equipments. For example, if you are going to rescue crocodile, then a person must know how to handle crocodile or how to handle snare to rescue the crocodile, and he must have some experience about it. So you want to involve experienced people with you while you are going to rescue the any animal. Understanding stress word. So again, this even stress word is quite deep, and you need a lot of scientific knowledge to understand it. But I'll just try to explain you guys as a like layman language. So basically, there are physiological and psychological changes which is up to extreme level in the animal body due to the some stress factors. And example of stress factors can be anything. For example, loss of human habitation, or maybe bad handling, or any animal that has been entered into some human habitation, and they might get frightened. And that we all know this adrenaline gland, which are responsible for this adrenaline hormones, which gets triggered during these stress factors activation, and that ultimately leads to extreme level of immunity loss and energy loss. So in such cases, their entire system is very confused, and animal gets very vulnerable during that time. So considering this stress word, one must always care for animal first and then humans, because humans are they are in their habitat only. Animal is the one which has lost its habitat and which is surrounded by human population, and in that time animal is the one who is much more serious. So understand this stress word. I would like to request all of you that you just go to this animal physiology and understand that how this stress works and how much vulnerable this animal gets while during this stress period. So one must understand, one must have this idea of stress while he is going to deal with any wild animal, because most of the veterinarians are dealing with domesticated or pet or stray animals, and those animals are very used and very much comfortable with our species, or I would say with Homo sapiens, that they do not have such a stress factor working as they are working in this wildlife. So when you are going to work with wildlife, you must have this trace word, very much understanding of this trace word, and you want to apply it while you are rescuing the particular animal you are going to deal with. Knowledge of natural history, this is another thing you should keep in mind, that any particular region you are working in that particular region, the native flora and fauna, which animals are there. For example, if you are in Gujarat, if you are working at Jaisor region or near to the Jaisor Wildlife Sanctuary, or I would say Palanpur region. So in Jaisor Wildlife Sanctuary, there are presence of a greater mammal, which is bear. So you must have idea that I have particular species around me, and I might get in future, or at any time I might get rescue operation or anything related to this animal. So you must have idea about physiology, its behavior, and everything the animal has in their peculiarity. So you must want to consider all of these things and have ideal knowledge of any animal you are surrounded with. Species consideration. So whenever you are going to rescue an animal, you must have idea that for which animal species I am going to perform a rescue operation. So again, as I said, if you are going to deal with bird, you will have you will need knowledge of different birds. You will need knowledge of different birds, and you will need different kind of equipments. You may need different kind of medicine with you. So also you should consider this species, like for which species I am going to deal with. Area consideration, that is also very important point to keep in mind, that in which particular geographical area you are going to deal with, whether there are mountains, whether it is desert, semi-desert area, whether it is grassland, or whether it is any deep forest like Purna Wildlife, Purna Sanctuary. So area consideration should be in mind. Time and weather. So if you are going to deal with any animal which is in jungle, and it's a season of monsoon, and it is very late in night, and there is heavy rainfall, so you should not perform wildlife rescue operation during this harsh weather conditions, because already you are going to deal with wild animals, and if during this harsh weather condition, if anything might get wrong, then whole rescue operation might get disturbed, and any human or animal injury can be happening. So we must consider time and weather also, and which is very basic thing to keep in mind is human safety. You should consider human safety, but here I would like to, as far as wildlife is concerned, you must consider animal safety first, and then human safety comes. Most of the books are considering human safety first, but I would like to say that animals are the most vulnerable animals are wildlife, and being a veterinarian, your role is to protect wildlife and then animals, humans. So you must consider human safety. You should keep in mind that human safety is also important thing. Then another thing is equipment. So equipments will also depend on the species you are going to deal with. There are various kind of cages, various kind of ropes. You might want to go deep down into the well, and then you might need any any support, and any rope which is quite easy to deal with, and which is not rough and very soft material, so it might not hurt you, and you can go down to the well very easily. If you want to tie any cage or any equipment, so in those cases you will need different kind of ropes. So there are various kind of ropes, and you should consider all of the in your rescue kit. There should be at least 2 to 3 different kind of thickness and different kind of material in rope. So nets are also there. There are two to three different kind of nets are available. One is metal made nets, which are you know, we should avoid using it. And net should be always having soft material, and it should be comfortable so that animal does not get injured. Dark color cloth, every veterinarian should include any dark green color cloth in his kit, in his or her kit, because whenever you are going to deal with, you should always cover their eyes or always cover their vision, so that they will have, by covering this eye, you are reducing a stress factor, that is humans. So by seeing humans around them, they will get very frightened, and it may trigger the stress. So when you are covering the eyes of animal or covering vision of animal, you are not allowing them to see surrounding, whatever is happening surrounding them. So yeah, it reduces its stress. So you should always consider dark green color cloth in your kit. Snares or hook, especially in case of smaller mammals, snares are used. In case of greater reptiles, for example, python, or I would say especially crocodiles, these snares are used. And in some other minor reptiles, for example, snake and other animals, hooks are usually used. Tranquilizing gun is also the one of the as far as wildlife is concerned, that one of the main equipment you should consider is tranquilizing gun. Medical kit, you should also consider surgical kit. Then torch, if you are going to deal during night, then almost everyone should have this torch with them. Measuring tape, because every animal which you are gonna encounter, you just want to collect as much data as possible you can. So you want to collect all the measurements of animal's body. For example, if you have encountered any leopard, so you just want to take basic records, for example, their sex. You just also want to measure their claws length, their body length, their heart girth width, all, and their tail, their ear, their teeth. So everything you want to include, you want to examine everything, and you should also measure everything. So you can have some basic study material for your own study. GPS reader is also, if you're going to deal in jungle region where there is no electricity, where there is no connection, you should keep this GPS reader with you. So you can take the recording of GPS, and you can have exact geographical idea of where you are supposed to deal or where you dealt with particular animal. Camera you should have, because you might need to take any documentation or any example photograph. So you must include camera with you. You should have a notebook to take various kind of field notes. Water and food supply, or even I would say mosquito net or tent, should be needed in some cases where you are going to live in jungle for 2 to 3 days, where there is no facility and you are supposed to examine the animal, or you are supposed to track animal, or where you are going to treat any animal, and you are you had to live there for like 2 to 3 days. So one must include mosquito nets. So these are some examples of equipments. So from left above, we'll start. There is one cage, which is leopard transportation cage, which is made as per the size of leopards, the in general ideal size of leopards. And these are transportation cage. So as per the animal, it depends, like size of the transportation cage depends as per the animal. So the first example is of leopard transportation cage. The second image from the left above is of this hook and tong, which are usually used in the rescue operation of reptiles. But again, here I would like to mention that if you are amateur rescuer, wildlife rescuer, or snake rescuer, you don't need to use these kind of equipments because you don't know how much pressure there is needed to squeeze animal's body, and you might apply some much more pressure and you might injure the spinal cord of a particular reptile. So I would like to say that if you have any experience working with this equipment, then and then only you are supposed to deal. Otherwise, there is actually no need of handling animal while the as far as these snakes are concerned. We will be discussing about its ideal handle method in upcoming slides. So the third image is of crocodile cage, and it is actually not that much needed. The crocodiles are rescued and it can be transported openly into this transportation vehicle. So sorry, it is not that much needed. Another fourth image is actually a collapsible cage, and that is designed specially for pythons and pangolins. So that is collapsible even for smaller mammals, for example civet and mongoose. So these kind of cages are used. Advantage of collapsible cage is like it can be collapsed and it can be expanded as per the size and area requirement of the animal. Another image is of demonstration of ropes. As I said, the cage might be needed to tie with ropes. So another example is a person going down there in the well with rope tied down around his body. The last image is showing the use of nets in case of there were a monkey, two to three monkeys were there, langur. They were stuck into the human habitat. So at the gate, there were two people. They had applied this net, and there were no need of tranquilizing animals. They were just when they opened that door, they just came into net, and very safely, the staff were able to release them back into the wild. So these were some examples of various equipments. Now we'll go to our third topic, which is approach for the ideal rescue operation. Approach, there are under approach there are certain points you should keep in mind, which is species of animal. So if you are going to rescue the monkey or any macaque or langur, so the approach to that animal will be different. They are very alert, active animals, and you want to avoid any disturbance to that animal, and you want to approach very slowly. In case of reptiles or crocodiles, you must approach very actively. You must be having very alertness, and while approaching to any big cats, for example tiger or leopard or lion, so during such cases you don't want to go walking on the ground. There should be always a safe vehicle, four wheeler with much more power to run in the jungle, and you must have that much safety with you. So also approach also depends on the species or size of the animal you are going to deal with. So you should consider species of the animal while approaching animal. Time also you should consider. For example, if animal is nocturnal animal and you are going to rescue them or you are going to treat them or catch them in the daytime, then you might not find them, or you might disturb them much more on a much more level, that you might induce stress to the animal and that animal might die even like before rescuing. So you must consider the animal. So every animal has a different kind of time zone during their entire day, and during that particular time they are much more active. So you, as per the species, you want to consider the time you are going to deal. Situation also you should consider. Situation, or I would say geography, both are quite same thing, that in which particular geography you are going to deal. If any animal is at the much more height than you, and that animal is particularly any carnivore, then you don't need to fire any dart or fire any equipment towards them to capture them, because they might easily attack on you, and you don't since you are, you know, at the much more down level, they might attack on you easily and you might get injured, or animal might get injured. So you should consider the geography. The on animal must be always at the lower height than you, so that is ideal condition to deal with animal. So now the topic goes to this restraining techniques. You like, when you are going to rescue, the ultimate thing you are going to do is restraining an animal and bringing them or keeping them to some safer place. So there are two main types of restraining, which is physical restraint or chemical restraint. Chemical restraint is also called this immobilization technique. So we'll go one by one. So physical restraint method depends on the species and size of the animal. So there are certain animals which are never handled by physical technique, because they get much more into much more stress. So you can see in the photograph that a leopard cub has been handled by me, and that animal, that cub was actually orphaned. So if the same sized cub is from wild, you should never handle those animals, even if it is cub, if it is from wild, and if it has some exposure in wild previously. So even at this age of cub, you should not handle with your hand. You should always go for chemical immobilization. Any adult animal which is big carnivore, or I would say any kind of carnivore, you should always handle those animals with chemical immobilization technique. Physical method is actually not allowed for them, and because it causes actually a lot of stress to the animal. And in general, the best method, the ideal animal species to be handled with physical method is actually birds and reptiles. Any other animal should be restrained with this chemical method only. And you should have various expertise, and like depended on the species you are going to deal with. So it requires a lot of expertise while you are handling animals with physical method. So any amateur rescuer should avoid handling any animal with help of this physical method, because you don't know how animal is going to react. You don't know whether the equipment is going to work perfectly or not. So animal, any human or any person who has dedicated his or her entire life rescuing for particular animal, so those people can they should be allowed to handle those animal physically. This method drawback is, as I said, it is it induces lot of stress. And another thing is it can be dangerous for both human or animal, because animal they are listening everything, they are hearing everything, they are seeing everything, and all of their perceptions are working perfectly, and so they are quite active and alert at that time, and they have this masking behavior also during this period. So they will not allow you to show whether they are injured or not, and you will feel like that animal is completely active and alert. So that behavior is actually called masking behavior. So it has various drawbacks. Physical method, I would say, ideally should be used in any minor operations, or for example, if you are going to examine the animal, if leopard is there and you are supposed to microchip that animal, or you are supposed to collect the blood of particular leopard, so you can use the squeeze cage. So for those especially carnivores and other greater mammals, squeeze cages are usually used. So you can squeeze animal into this cage, and they will be restrained physically. But that method is also ideal for like maximum 15 minute operation, for example, physical examination or blood collection or microchipping and all. If the work is going to be for a longer period of time, then you are supposed to choose this chemical immobilization. So we'll again, these are some bad examples of physical handling. You should not handle any animal with your bare hand, because recent corona situation is also an example. There are various examples. We are seeing these zoonotic diseases are spreading. So always prefer wearing gloves or protective wears while you are going to handle the animal, because you don't know what kind of infection they are carrying, and you might be carrier of any infectious disease after rescuing or handling any animal. So never handle any bird barehandedly, any kind of animal so far with bare hand. And you should never handle the kite like this. The person who is handling two Indian rock pythons, this is also this classic example of bad handling. You should never handle any kind of reptile like this. One monitor lizard is being handled with its tail. So reptiles have this tendency, they lose their tails when they are held. So you should avoid handling reptiles like this. And the lower left image, you can see the animal, this human is having two common crate snakes. Common crate snakes are one of the venomous snakes found in the one of the most venomous snake found in this all over India. So this is very immaturity and lack of knowledge. And we should always having the ideal knowledge of species you are going to deal with. So these are all examples that shows us and tells us that what veterinarians should keep in mind while dealing with wildlife. So we'll see one by one the ideal physical handling method for reptiles. So as I said, reptiles and especially snakes are there is no need of even this tong or any kind of hand handling. You can use any gunny bag or pillow cover or any kind any black color, dark colored cloth will be more preferable, because it gives darkness to that particular area, and animal thinks that it is any burrow or so, and animal will easily try to go in that. So you are supposed to ideal width of you are supposed to apply this PVC pipe of ideal width as per the reptile you are going to deal with, so that it can enter into that PVC pipe. So it should be very it should be not very long, like 2 to 3 inch pipe will work. And on that pipe you are allowed like you are supposed to tie this gunny bag's end, so that entire area is so you are making entire artificial burrow for particular snake, and then you are just with help of this stick or tong, you just guide to that animal and that reptile, and that snake will easily enter to that burrow looking structure you have created. And suddenly just after snake enters into this burrow you have created, you just keep the tong or stick and just remove the PVC pipe, and you can tie a knot around it, and then you can easily release that animal into the wild. So that was for snakes specially. Now we'll talk about crocodiles. So snare is usually used in rescuing crocodile. So first and foremost, if that animal is in the water or on the ground, you need to apply snare. Length of snare should be quite long, because crocodiles might be like up to 18 feet long. So while you're going to deal with that animal, you have to apply. So the stick of the snare should be quite long. And then you are apply to you are supposed to apply snare on this neck region of the animal. So throughout the world, any crocodile or alligator handler or rescuer, so there are two ideal techniques they are using while applying snare. So in one technique, they are applying snare in between the jaws. So usually crocodiles keep their jaws open, so it is very easy to apply snare in between jaw. But I would recommend the other method, because this method actually, when you apply in between jaw, then like immediately after applying, the crocodile will do its death roll. And during its death roll, they are very energetic, very energetic, and they are applying their full force. and they are rolling. So while doing this, you might, like, instead of saving the animal, you might get them injured. Like whenever anyone is applying snare to in between jaw, like in all of the cases I have seen that their teeth get easily broken. So I would recommend that you should apply snare on the neck region and around the both of the upper and lower jaw. So it will be much more beneficial for you and as well as these crocodiles. So immediately after applying snare, you are supposed to, one person is supposed to jump immediately on its, so before you will have to have this dark color cloth and cover its eyes. So when animal's eyes is cover, eyes are covered, then it will be very submissive in nature. And then immediately you are supposed to jump on the jaws of animal, or I would say the neck region of the animal, and apply your full force to its upper jaw so that it cannot be easily get open. Again, crocodiles cannot easily open its jaw. They can close it very powerfully, but while it is about to like open, they have very struggle. They have very much struggle while opening its jaw. So when you are applying force, it will be partially restrained. Then immediately when first person sets on the neck, two to three other person, depending on the length of the crocodile, they are supposed to sit on them, and the foreleg and hind leg, they are supposed to held them and keep bring them at the dorsum region of, region of the animal's body, and tie them with softer ropes, because if you are using any metal material or quite rough rope, then you might injure its scales or leg. So avoid using any harsh material and go for softer material rope. It will be beneficial for both you. You will have, you know, very less work to do after rescuing animal if you are working with this kind of materials, very harsh materials. Then you might injure, someone might injure that animal in between, and then you will have to work much more. Instead of just releasing, you might need to take its x-ray, then the entire case might get complicated. So this is the ideal method for rescuing the, or I would say restraining the crocodiles. Again, in India, in our Gujarat, there is this Magar crocodile only, and throughout the India there are three species of crocodiles. One of them is Gharial, which is from Schedule 1, and they have very vulnerable status in currently this native wild habitation. So as I said, there are squeeze cages are there which are used. So squeeze cages are just like normal metal cage, but there is a separate compartment, or I would say there is a separate wall in it, which is attached externally to this gear system. So one person is supposed to use this wheel to turn it, and this entire wall will be moving, and animal will be get eventually squeezed, and then you can perform like 10 to 15 minutes operation. Whether you have like, if you are working in zoo, then you might need to give this annual vaccination. You might need to check this microchip of particular animal. So those are like 5 to 10 minutes work. So you can perform those kind of work in the squeeze cage. For bird, this is ideal method of handling. As I said, this photograph shows the ideal method of handling. This is an image of Dr. Nitesh Chaudhary at Sardar Patel Kevadia Zoological Park. They are handling this Indian peafowl. You must wear mask. You must wear this gloves. Protective, all the protective gears you have, then always cover the eye of bird, and rest of the entire body is also covered with soft towel so that it might get comfortable. Another thing is, birds have these like quite more level of temperature than we as a human or other mammals have. So, and they tend to go to hyperthermia very easily in any situation. And most of the problems like birds are facing even during this kite flying festival and throughout the year, that is hypothermia, and that ultimately leads to shock. So considering the temperature, ideal temperature of these birds, you always cover their entire body with towel and always keep them warm, because there it is very much possible to that animals, these birds' body temperature might get down very easily. So you consider it, and this is very ideal photographic classical example of bird handling. So you should consider handling bird like this way only. Now we'll talk about this chemical immobilization. This topic itself is quite big and it requires like a lot of understanding, but again, as a this is very basics we are talking about. So considering all student and working wildlife, I will just make clear some fundamentals for you guys, that in future if you get any encounter of rescuing animal with the help of dart gun, then you will already have some ideas clear in your mind, and it will be very easier for you to perform in the wild. So for chemical immobilization, the dart gun is usually used. And chemical immobilization, like main the product which is used for immobilizing, it is, they are chemicals, or we can say drugs are used. And they are actually working, they act on this nervous system. And so you are supposed to use those drugs. And this, again, this method is exclusively for veterinarians only. Physical handling can be done by any expert animal, any expert person from any field. But as far as this chemical immobilization is concerned, always should be performed by a veterinarian or under the observation of veterinarian. You might get any forest official who say that I just want to dart that animal, or I want to perform this operation. So it is, as a veterinarian, it is your responsibility to explain them, and it is your responsibility that if you are allowing it to happen, then it should be veterinarian's observation, because it requires a lot of knowledge, lot of understanding. The knowledge of anesthesia, knowledge of immobilization should be there, and knowledge of particular drug you are going to use in that any particular rescue operation. So comparatively, compared to this physical restraint, it is less risky, because you have ample amount of time. Animal is completely, I would not say completely, but partially unconscious. And for animal and human, it is beneficial. Animal will not try to escape, or will not try to attack to any person, because it cannot act that way. So that there will be a lesser chance of animal and human this injury. Another thing is comparatively less stressful for the animal. So again, when you are dealing with particular animal, when you are dealing when they are alive, so they are, as I said, they are watching, they are listening everything, they are watching everything. So it leads to stress to particular animal. And when they are chemically immobilized, their perceptions are compromised, and they will not understand what is happening around them. And then ultimately it will cause less stress compared to this physical handling method. It also allows time, like it is, when it is immobilization is concerned, it is in your hand only, that how, for how much longer period you want animal to be subconscious or unconscious. So yeah, it is much more beneficial that way, that you will have ample amount of time. You can perform any kind of operations. You can transform that animal from one place to another place. You can perform any surgical operation to them. You can perform any sample collection method which requires very deep. For example, recent outbreak in Gir National Park, like last year that happened for this CD outbreak. So the doctors throughout the Gir National Park and Wildlife Sanctuary needed to tranquilize them, so that it was like much more beneficial for both animal and human, because plenty of time required to collect samples, the oronasal samples, rectal samples. and then packing them, then checking the other health aspect of the animal, taking other parameters. So you can work very comfortably without any problem. So this should be considered. So now we'll see some examples of darting equipments. So the left above image is of blowpipes, and blowpipes are usually used in this very less distance between animal and whenever there is very less distance between doctor and animal. So for example in zoo, so they are in cages only, and you can go at the these cage bars and you can just blow this needle to towards their body. And so in such closed distance or close encounter, you can use these blowpipes. But also apart from this, using dart gun, it needs another kind of expertise. So yeah, you must have some prior knowledge about using this blowpipe. Another second image, there is two rifles there were previously used. So the pump that were used to fill the air into the vehicle tires. So similar pumps were used to create air pressure into these rifles, and then the dart was being darted. And now the green image, which is the left one, and the lower one, which is browner, those are bigger dart gun, and those are currently being used throughout the like India, or I would say world. There are 2 to 3 hardly companies, those are making these darting equipments. One is tail inject and one is den inject. The gun which is having green colored, and the right above, which is from Dash Inject company and den inject company, and this tail inject company is there. So again, there are like various kind of guns available with various kind of performance. So there is previously, as I said, there used to be a use of this air pressure pump, but currently this technology has led this gun to be very well equipped, and there is a CO2 cartridge is there. So you can fire up to 30 to 40 shots using this CO2 single cartridge. So there is a pressure of carbon dioxide gas created into this cartridge, and that allows you to create the pressure, the desirable pressure by the veterinarian as per the distance between this animal and doctor. So another thing there is in this darting gun is a control of pressure is on you only, and you can control the amount of pressure you need. There is one switch given in every dart gun, and one meter is given. So playing with this switch and observing the meter, you can have idea that with this much amount of pressure or this much bar pressure, I can create this much, I can cover this much distance. So that everything comes with experience and trial and error method. So no veterinarian is 100% expert in everything, because as far as you are working with wildlife, every day is new for you. So everything comes with interest and trial and error method. So okay, we'll discuss something about drug. So always consider that drug should be having high therapeutic index, and it should be non-irritant to muscle, because it might cause irritation and animal might not get induced with anesthesia, because they get much more alert than prior. So you should avoid irritation causing drugs. It should be high therapeutic index, as I said. High potency should be there, and so short induction period is always desired, because you are dealing with wild animal, and when you dart them and the induction period is quite longer, the drug you are using, then the animal might run away and you may lost animal. The animal might have fallen, run away somewhere and fallen into well, and you might be finding it somewhere else and it might die. So you just want to avoid all of these problems because of this longer induction period. So always choose this short induction period drug. And yes, again, important thing is antidote should be available and it should be with you all the time whenever you are going to use this chemical immobilization method. And it should be longer shelf life because like once you get the drug, your wildlife is not like you are getting rescue operations every day. So you might want to use this drug for like a longer period of time. And so it should be having longer shelf life. So it should be easily available whenever you need it. Okay, so these are the types of the animals and recommended drug for those animals. So again, this is I would say exclusively for India, because this is data collected from our Indian veterinarians that what they are using. So in general, for most of the animals, ketamine and xylazine, mixture of ketamine xylazine is used. As far as greater or I would say big carnivores are concerned, the veterinarians who are working in wildlife are using ketamine and xylazine with 100 mg concentration. So drug with that concentration is desirable. And in most of the animals, either birds, reptiles, primates, canines or felines, you can use ketamine and xylazine as per the doses. Again, you should not like consider the dose you have been reading or you have been referred to, because it depends on the geographical area, again for the animal, and individuality also depends on the drug's action. So always go for this learning first, and then depended on your learning and your experience, you apply considering the ideal dose, apply your personal input in it, so it will be much more beneficial that way. And some big herbivores, for example, these mega herbivores are elephants and rhinos. So in even these bisons, in those particular animals, atorphine is used, that is atorphine hydrochloride, and phencyclidine is also used in these minks, and I would say this mongoose or honey badger or skunk or civet. So these kind of drugs can be used. So after you have tranquilized the animal, there are certain points you should keep in mind after tranquilizing or capturing an animal. So these are some again thumb rules to keep in mind while you're dealing in man-animal conflict or you're resolving any rescue operation. So try to approach toward the animal even after being tranquilized. Try to approach toward the animals with patience and care, because you have tranquilized and as per the ideal induction period, the animals, you think that it has been tranquilized and it has been unconscious completely, but it might, as I said, individuality matters, and in every individual animal body, drug will react differently, or its induction will be dependent differently. So you consider it, and whenever you think that animal, the drug has worked and you want to approach towards animals, you just go slowly from distance first. You just confirm that animal is completely unconscious or subconscious, and then only you try to approach towards it. If animal is tranquilized, first confirm it from distance. As I said, you just confirm it from distance. You can use certain voice or longer stick to poke the animal, and the animal's body reaction might let you know that particular animal is being tranquilized. Always cover the, after approaching or after reaching towards the animal, first and foremost thing you need to do if it is tranquilized is that you need to cover its eyes, because their senses have compromised, but not completely. So their senses works somewhat potency so that you compromise that also. So you just cover the eyes of animal, and if that is animal is supposed to be kept in that stage for like longer period of life, you just open up your normal saline bottle and just pour some drops of NS in eyes or in eyes as well as in mouth. So because of this atropinic reaction happening into the body, that all the secretions will be compromised, and eye or mouth may get dry. So you just want to neutralize it and maintain quiet environment. That is a very important thing, because there should be very few people should be there, should be not very crowded, and you should avoid any kind of noise or any kind of audible disturbances to the animal. Try to minimize movements while handling or transforming. Yes, you should minimize your movement while you know handling it. You just don't want to, even if it is tranquilized, just don't think it as its dead body, and think it as it's like a live body, and you are handling it, and just go like that. Okay, now like you will have time to examine the animal after tranquilizing it. So what you should look for examination, first and foremost thing is whether that animal has any visible or non-visible injuries there. You should go for temperature record. You should go for respiration, heart rate, pulse rate. You should also check for dehydration. You should check for these ectoparasites. If they have, you can check visible mucous membranes. And you can also check what their sex is, their aging. So in big cats, usually aging is done by examining their teeth. So structure, these anatomical visual structures are, they have been classified as per the ages. So yeah, you can have ample amount of time for examining the animal. Okay, so management after rescuing, or you know, after the animal is under your observation or under your control. So after transferring animal, always cover the cage with cloth or gunny bag, because this is especially for big cats. When you are rescuing any animal from any human habitat, there will be like thousands of people will be there, and there will be a one leopard, and there it will be like struggling to go out, and it will be it must be frightened and very aggressive. And when it sees more people, it tries to escape. And as seen in this image in the left, while one leopard was rescued from this Gi region, and it wasn't covered properly. So and even these thousands of people are there, no one is under your control. So they will just try to come and try to examine the animal, that whether they have because like they think that they are expert, and they just want to confirm that whether they have captured the exact animal or not. And this animal will get frightened. They will try to attack animal, and then animal will try to attack to the human beings, and it will get itself injured, and again it leads to this blood loss and muscle injury and complicate the case. So just try to cover the entire cage as per the shown in image right, and then you can transport the transportation cage to desired place. Your desirable place to transport the animal should be nearest one. It can be rescue center, rehabilitation center, or maybe if you just it doesn't require any medical attention, then you just want to release them in the nearest wildlife habitat. So this is again while transporting the animal when they are kept. These are some example. The image in the left above is the example of keeping monitor lizard or any reptile, which is very wrong way. People, most of the rescuers throughout the India or even in our Gujarat, they are the reptile rescuers. They usually just keep any reptile. They keep it in any plastic or plastic bottle or any kind of just. Bottle is there, and they just make one hole in there, and they transport it to any particular area they want to take it with. And that is, I think, very wrong way, because there should be some bedding material, there should be proper ventilation, because ventilation is actually needed as far as reptiles and birds are concerned. and the entire place should be very dark, because also you just want to compromise their senses with making their environment very dark, and you should follow that only. So like as per the shown in the image right above, you can see some python babies are kept under this wood saw, and so it is very comfortable bedding material for reptiles and birds. And you can see the basket is very ventilated, so it should be like this, because if you are not maintaining any good ventilation and safety transportation cage, animal might try to escape, and it might lead to injure themselves. Like the scene in the image below, the star tortoise is it has lost its all of the scales trying to escape from the cage. Okay, so if you have any external or injury, especially external injury you have encountered by after rescuing animal, then your first and foremost step will be this wound management. And there are some points to consider in mind, like always wear protective, as I said, whenever you are rescuing, or like any kind of dealing with animal is done under like protecting done with protecting wears only. And you always like, as far as wildlife is concerned, you should use some excessive use of chemicals on the body of animal. So first and foremost thing is cleaning the wound, and cleaning the wound should be done with normal saline only. Nothing more is needed. As far as wildlife is concerned, you don't need to worry about maintaining much more aseptic environment and much more aseptic wound. You just flush it with a normal saline solution, and it can be cleaned with it. Use sterile mop and sterile cotton material, and if that is bird, then remove feather materials from surrounded to this wound, or if it is animal or mammal, then clear the area of surrounding the wound, and you can have clear idea of how much wound has been spread. So you can also collect this bacteriological swab. Like you are dealing with wildlife is like purely exotic to like all of these our personal ecosystem we have developed, so they must have different kind of organisms they must be carrying. They must be having very serious zoonotic disease that animal might be carrying. So you consider those thing, and as a part of your, like, you are not only a going to treat animal, you are considering the one health of like entire globe in your mind, and you want to study deeper in those things. So you should always collect bacteriological swab and maximum amount of samples you can without disturbing animal. And yeah, that is also a thing to consider. Use normal saline, as I said. In case of maggot wound, you can use chloroform is actually used, but it is quite irritating. So you can use any natural thing if you want. Then you can use this ivermectin so that maggots will be dead within a days, and apply antiseptic powder, and again, no much antiseptic precaution is needed. You just use any minor, for example, zinc oxide or any Ayurvedic preparation is there, then also it will work. You can apply. Also, keep in mind that whatever the agent you are going to apply, that ingredient should be in like it should be very sticky material, so that it sticks to the body, and you don't need to apply it like for time to time. Take sutures if necessary. Yeah, if there is maggot wound, like always you'll encounter this maggot wound as far as wildlife is concerned, because immediately they are not rescued, and they will, after like injury has spread a lot, and then you will get it. So there will be a lot of maggot wound cases in this wildlife injury. So there is no need of taking sutures in wildlife, this maggot infested wounds. While using drugs, you just need to choose whether it is necessary or not. Like most of the veterinarians are using ample amount of drugs in domesticated and stray animals or pet animals. So that practice, I would say, it is not allowed ideally or ethically, because those wildlife animals are not very much exposed to these drugs, and they don't have any kind of resistance. And we are usually used to give this overdose to animals. So you should avoid using antibiotic at all. And if like it is needed and you think that it might got systematic and it might affect animal at a greater stage, so then only you should prefer to give antibiotic. And steroids are usually used in wildlife. I would also prefer using steroids over NSAID, but that is also like if it is necessary, then you just give it. But otherwise, always control your use of injectables and especially antibiotics or painkiller, or I would say especially this NSAID and steroids. So the reason why I was telling about this immunity, that like about not using lot of antibiotic in this wild animal, is like we encountered a female that was trying to enter into human habitation, one farm, and it got injured. The fence was very sharp and it got injured herself, and the wound was quite bigger, like maybe 10 centimeter wound length was there, and it was sutured immediately. Like another day it was encountered, it was DC was tranquilized, the wound was like it was flushed with normal saline only, and then it was sutured. And then only drug that were given was a dose of these multivitamins. Long acting antibiotic I chose, that was anthrofloxacin LA. And then again I chose, as I said, I like using steroids. I personally like using steroids in the wild animal because it is very much, you know, it gives faster results, and you don't need to, there are lesser chance of toxicity in the steroidal drugs than this NSAID and all. And yeah, so prednisolone was given. So as per the dose, the prednisolone was like 5 ml was given. And again, these are bigger animals. You don't have, you know, your weighing scale all around in the jungle and all over all the time with you. So there are some, as per the age group, so as per the dentition, as I said, there has been made some age groupings. And during considering those age groupings, the various weight are given to these particular animals. And yeah, so as per the 5 ml prednisolone was given, and this antibiotic was given, and so it was given for one time, then it was released in back to wildlife, and it was rescued in wild and released wild there only. And then again when she encountered while applying this collars to these wild lions, so when we encountered her again, like it was like 6 to 8 months, and no secondary treatment was given to her. And the image in the right is the photograph of the same female. So you can see there were one suture remaining only, and everything was healed. No any repetitive therapy or any kind of attention was given to her. So I would say wildlife has quite a good amount of immunity compared to our domesticated animals, which are very much overused drugs there. Okay, so you might get few things. This is the first one is shock. You might get dehydration when you're, if there is not wound, then animal must be in shock. That must be dehydration. So few things are there which are in general when you're encountering any wildlife. Then there will be few things, either hyperthermia, either dehydration, either wound or shock. So in case of shock, it is actually caused by this stress. Stress can be anything. It can be blood loss. It can be, you know, this a fight or flight response caused by this man-animal conflict or anything. So there is low blood pressure is there, and there might be severe blood loss. So you just correct blood loss. You can also, like always, you should go for this fluid therapy as far as shock is concerned. And you should, when there is animal is in shock, it should be in like dark environment. You can use steroid if you want. And ventilation in dark environment should be there. Dehydration is also another thing you will be encountering, and that is like basically due to decreased water intake. There must be hyperthermia in dehydration. Fever, chronic vomiting can be a cause of dehydration. Fever can be a cause of dehydration. You should not use in dehydration, you just avoid using tranquilizing, you just go for physical restraining, and you just don't use this steroid also. You just go for fluid therapy, supporting treatment, and very, again, low use of antibiotics. There is another group of animals or another condition of animal that requires very separate and separate attention. That is orphans. So orphans are basically, as I said, if their mother has been killed or in fight, or it has been the cub or any baby has been rejected by any mother from the wild. So we should rescue those animals, and those animals need much more attention. And we should always go for single person deal while we are dealing with these orphan animals. So if as a veterinarian you are dealing with animal, then all this feeding and medicine and personal care should be done by you only. But if you have any like keeper or any animal handler is there who are much more comfortable with animal, so any single animal should maintain, and any single human should maintain and raise the animal. Because you if in future you plan to release that those animal into the wild, then like lower human imprint will help them to recover and rehabilitate more into their natural habitat. So you should consider that in mind. You should provide warmth, because orphan animals need warmth. Gentle handling should be there. Remember, whether even it is carnivore, then and like big cat is there, like any leopard cub is there, you should always handle him very gently, because considering their age, frequent observation should be there. Like you should be observing them very frequently. You should environment should be quite sterile compared to like this adult animals, because they are orphans, and compared to adult animals, even in the wildlife, their orphan animals immunity will be quite at lower level. Then you should consider the sterile environment, minimize human interaction, as I said, and single and expert keeper should be there. And also include supplementation in the feeding you are giving. Housing and management of animals after rescuing, a place to protect from adverse animal environmental condition, which is called housing. It should be like suitable for the particular species you are going to deal with. There should be accessible feeding, water intake. There should be very good the sewage system, so that all the excreted material of the animal can be removed very easily. There should be two compartments, or at least, so that one compartment, when it is being cleaned, that animal can be transported to another one. And to protect particular species from another species, so you should consider keeping birds with birds only. You should not for example keep any recently electrocuted monkey you have rescued, and when you are keeping that cage in front of leopard's cage, then that particular animal, instead of recovering it, it will get in much more deeper stress. My monkey might get even it may die because of just fear of animal beside him. So consider different species and work according to that. And again, all the medication and supplementation, while it is like while they are in house or being housed, then you just give all the medication and supplementation in the oral form. So just in feed you give it as per the desirable doses. Never forget to provide endangerment. So endangerment is quite deep topic. So basically that thing is, it is actually works as a stress recover. So when we are keeping animal, even we have rescued it, and when we are keeping them for 2 to 3 days, we are like thinking them that this particular animal is safe, but as per the animal's perspective, that animal is not in its natural habitat. It is in cage or in some room or so. So it will like continuous triggering of the stress factor, which is like habitat loss. It has lost its natural habitat. It is out of completely its comfort zone. So it will cause much more stress. And to reduce it, the practice that is being done is called environmental enrichment. So environmental enrichment is basically providing in cage, or I would say in situ, those kind of environment and that is also dependent to the species. If you are having a bird or I would say a kite, then you need any kind of perch, 2 to 3 different level perch should be there, wooden perch should be there, so they can sit there and they can have a comfortable environment. It should be covered, no much more human peeping should be there, like peeping should be there, like they are, everyone is visiting the rescue center or any this protected area and they are visiting these caged animals, so it should not be allowed because they need they are wild animal, they are not used to human, they should be kept at like some privacy. Never forget to as I said, provide enrichment. Okay, so while they are being housed or they are being under your observation, despite like apart from collecting this blood collection and other samples, you can also go for scat collection. Scat collection will give you variety of idea and will give you variety of understanding. You can have various kind of endoparasites, eggs, even grown adult endoparasites. You can go for trichography. You can have idea of knowing of food that particular animal that has been consuming since its life, and some ectoparasites also you can collect. So these are some examples of samples collected from the wildlife. Now, like rehabilitation of even after like you have solved everything, you have solved your conflict, you have solved, you have rescued animal, the animal has been recovered, then you need to rehabilitate back because it has been like captured from the wild or its natural habitat. You always need them to be released like into their natural habitat. So before releasing them, there are some points that you should keep in mind, that if they are being compromised, then you should delay rescue this releasing the animal. So you should observe its behavior before releasing it, confirm that animal is healthy and alert enough to be released. You can go for certain physiological responses, choose correct habitat. So if you want to release any reptile or for example crocodile is there, then you don't need to release it in the middle of the jungle. You should select any water body so that it can flourish there very well. So you should correct ideal habitat as dependent on the species you are going to release back into the wild. So choose correct timing also. If you have any nocturnal animal, for example, we can say you have rescued any pangolin, and pangolin is actually a nocturnal animal and it is very rare mammal, and it is active in night time only. So if you release them into the daytime, very daylight, then it will be very difficult for animal to get acclimatized back to its wildlife. So you should consider the correct timing as per the species you are going to release. Provide enough food and water before releasing it, and during transportation you just avoid giving water and food supply. But the cages that are the transportation cages should be very well ventilated and very well covered, so that visual compromise can be done. In case of birds, include perch. Yeah, in case of birds, you just need to give this perch so that while transportation they might have a good grip and they might survive the transportation well. Take care of animal and human safety before releasing, because if any wild carnivore is there, like for example you are releasing any tiger or leopard back into the wild, then you are not supposed to be standing there into the its way, because after releasing it might go run anyway. So every person's safety should be considered, even human animal safety should be considered. Try to keep silence because animal might get frightened and it might run or get injured again, and you just need to rescue that animal again. Try to keep silence, observe them from some time after releasing. You just observe them, their behavior, like how they are going and all their walk and their responses, so that you can have a very good confirmation that it will be having no problem back into the wild. So there is one example of leopard release. We used to encounter a lot of leopards and we used to release them back into the wild. So there's a in the middle of the national park they are released so that no human habitation is like nearby, and the further a man-animal conflict can be resolved. So in first image you can see that cage is there on the this transportation van, and no human is like allowed to stand outside on the way of leopard, and one pulley like system is you know constructed by this department, and it is very easy, and you just need to pull a rope from the inside this rescue van, and you just don't need to go out there, and the door gets opened, and animal does not see any kind of human out there, and it sees its wild, its natural habitat back in front of its eyes. So they very easily get you know released back into the wild. So with this I am just concluding my topic, and I would like to request Sudha sir so that we can proceed for this question and answer session if we have time.
You are now unmuted.
Thank you, Dr. Harsh, for your beautiful presentation. So, now let us see question. One question from Dr. Harmit Kumar Patel. He want to know about the, is there any public health problem arising from the zoos?
Sir, can you please again read that question, sir?
Is there any public health problem arising from the zoo?
As far as as per my experience, I don't know that any till day there are no any public health issue rising. But one should consider since animals are wild and they must be carrying because some animal might be coming from the wild and they might be carrying certain infectious diseases. For example, I would like to mention one disease is tuberculosis, right? That is zoonotic and that is seen in some of the zoos. And so that is one, possibilities to think about that tuberculosis and such a zoonotic disease can be arising from the zoo. And to prevent it, always most of the staffs and most of the human and animal the dealing which is happening, it should be done under protective and preventive measures should be taken, and then you can prevent it. But few diseases are there which are which might get spread from zoo animals to humans.
Okay, thank you, sir. Mr. Manav Arora want to know, did you attend any institute of special interest in wildlife after BVSC, or everything you learn in the field?
Okay, so being a veterinarian, I know that we are not we are getting only 6 months of semester dedicated to wildlife, and we all know that it is very deep subject to study, and much more time should be given for a student, and it also requires much more expertise and much more expert teachers. So there are few institutions are there that I know of, and one of them is I would mention is this WII. This is Wildlife Institute of India, that is situated in Dehradun. And that is the only sole body governed by this government and working only for this wildlife throughout the India. And they have this special sheets, reserved for people like us, like veterinarians. So there can be, you can apply there. So there is every 2 year the program opens. So after every 2 year, they conduct this examination. So if you want to enroll into any kind of program, you just need to give this entrance examination, and then after passing it, you can be allowed to enroll in any kind of diploma or any BSc kind of program you want to study. And you're being a veterinarian, you can study and you can have knowledge of every all this flora and fauna, including like the conservation to hai, lekin including like you can also perform being a veterinarian. So they have these special seats and you will learn a lot of thing there. So another thing is like there is one another institute which is I think in MP Jabalpur is there. So in Jabalpur there is one entire department is dedicated to wildlife, and even in this Tanuvas they are offering one separate course for wildlife for if you want to go for this MBSC. So yeah, you can go for that. And like I know of our three institutes are there. So the main one is I would say this WII, Wildlife Institute of India.
Okay, thank you, doctor. One question from Muskan: why corticosteroid is preferred even its delay healing?
Okay, see, corticosteroids are given actually as per my experience, I would like to say that corticosteroids are usually given to like alleviate chronic pain, acute pain. So like wound healing is very natural process. So by giving drugs, you are not delaying or increasing speed of the healing process. So naturally wound will get healed. All you need to take care is the wound or anything that is you have treated that was quite sterile, and you have given, if it was mandatory, then you had give this antibiotic, and to relieve from present pain and alleviate certain conditions, you are giving, and that also steroids compared to this NSAID steroids works for like very lesser amount of time. So they are like temporary pain relief, and they also alleviate certain stress level. And then when they are back to wild, they are go to go, and there won't be any problem. But when you are like preferring any NSAID, you like not enough study has been done. Well, NSAID is concerned, like even in dogs, people are saying that people are nowadays, some veterinarians are considering giving avoiding meloxicam, and now they are realizing that meloxicam has such a bad effect in. So these are compared to those animals, these are the wildlife, and they are not like much study has been done compared to those domesticated animals. So those are strong animals compared to steroids. Like steroids are, the body are used to steroids because steroid hormones are nothing but this composition only. So body is used to steroids, and that is why I would prefer to give steroids over these chemicals, and I would say NSAID.
Thank you, Dr. Harsh. One question from my side, can you give the few suggestions to our budding vets regarding the rescue management of particularly wildlife animals in very brief?
In very brief, I would like to say that all you need to do is like people always say that there is nothing in reading. All you need to like all you can get is from this experience only. But even in wildlife, it is not like that. You just need to read a lot and lot. I was reading for my this because of my wildlife interest. I was reading for them like since my first year of veterinary college. So you need a lot of things, and then you start visiting. I would like to suggest every one of you who are interested in wildlife, all you need to do is like if you're a student, just start visiting NGOs, start visiting zoo. You just contact your nearest zoo veterinary officer. You can show them your interest, and they can you are then be allowed, so that you can brush up yourself. And because in your 5 year of education, you are not going to get that much knowledge about wildlife. So all you need to do is like study by yourself. You can approach to various institutes, you can approach to various NGOs as a volunteer, and you can work accordingly, and then it eventually come like as an experience. But initially you need to have some idea about zoology aspect and biology aspect, physiology aspect, superficial every aspect of our veterinary field. You should have some superficial knowledge so that you can avoid certain problems arising in the rescue operation.
Okay, Thank you, Dr. Harsh. I would like to submit some words regarding our veterinary. All the students, those are joined us in this webinar, I would like to say that the veterinary is very wide field. Okay. So if you know everything, the theoretical part is different and practical part is different. Dr. Harsh incorporated both the theory as well as the practical. So if you only know the theory, there is no meaning. If you only know the practical, there is no meaning. So incorporate both the parts and then you can get the better result. Okay. So thank you, Dr. Harsh. Now, at the end of section, I would like to request Dr. Deepak Sutar, organizing secretary of this webinar series, for what of thanks. Dr. Deepak, please.
Thank you, Dr. Harsh Prajapati. Very nice presentations and very well explains. So this webinar will be definitely helpful to our wildlife field veterinarians. Dr. Harsh, really very thank you to in within short period to accept our invitations and prepare very nice presentations regarding the wildlife. So once again, thank you, Dr. Harsh. And I am also thankful to all the participants who joined with us. Without your support, this series is nothing. So next week, I will meet with the new speaker with the new topic. Till then, namaskar, goodbye.
Sir, I would.
Yes.
I would like to say that. So the wildlife protection I was talking about. So we will be also giving like whoever participants want it. I would like to give away this this PDF file of this Wildlife Protection Act.
Yes.
So it will be given to everyone, and I would like to request that every veterinarian who is budding vet or like who has been working for like 30 years even.
Yes.
So they just read about Wildlife Protection Act, and they will have certain idea, and they can be like they can work accordingly into their like career.
Yes. So please send on my email address. So I will. Send to all the participants. So all
sure,
of these
sir.
People and sure, YouTube links and Facebook link already I have sent it, but this PDF file please send me. So send to all the participants. Thank you.
Sure.
Heartily thankful to Dr. Harsh Prajapati give the very nice presentation.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You are now muted.